Thank you very much. So this is going to be at a different scale. It's a newly started project in the Dallas-Fort Worth area, and my core authors are Nick Fang, Xinbao Yu, and Jin Gao at UT Arlington, Michael Zink at UMass, and Branko Kerkez at Michigan. Thank you. Okay, so this is the motivation for this project. It turns out that roughly 75% of the US population lives in 3% of the land area in the US. So if we can improve and integrate sensing, modeling, analysis, decision support in a predictive mode, we can help these cities address many of these issues related to sustainability. And this is important in places like Dallas-Fort Worth, where the magnitude of heavy to extreme rainfall has been increasing. So we want to be able to see, in a scale transparent way, what the impact may be to things like water infrastructure under climate change. So in an urban setting, you want to be able to do this at the highest possible resolution, at the finest scale. And for this, we need very highly accurate and high resolution rainfall information. And in Dallas-Fort Worth, we are lucky to have this DFW urban testbed composed of currently several X-band CASA weather radar systems, which will be expanded to roughly 8 locations to cover the entire DFW. Okay, so this is a comparison between what these high resolution radar systems may give you versus the Weather Service standard QPE product represented by MPE on the left hand side at the 4 kilometer hourly scale. The CASA QPE comes in at roughly 500 meter and 1 minute time resolution. So you can do a high-resolution hydrologic modeling at the city scale. This is using the Weather Service model HLRDHM, and be able to simulate runoff in the upper right corner and stream flow in the lower right corner, forced by the high-resolution rainfall information. And you can provide very location and time-specific warning information for flash flood forecasting, for example. And then depending on where the threats may be more enhanced, you can go to the cloud and essentially run hydraulic, location-specific hydraulic models for inundation mapping. You're looking at water depth as well as water velocity to warn the motorists. And now the question is, how accurate is any of this stuff? And the answer is no one really knows, because there are no real-time sensors to verify this. We only have anecdotal historical observations in different places. So if you compare against imaginary 100-year event inundation map, there are places where match is reasonable, and there are places where aren't any good matches. So we want to deploy additional sensors, but in such a way that we can gather a large amount of observations through crowdsourcing and deploy additional rain gauges with the help of Louisiana Lafayette and Imad Habib, and also deploy soil moisture sensors and water level and basic water quality sensors in different places. So let me show you some of the pictures. So this is the water level and quality sensor we'll be deploying roughly at 20 different locations in DFW. It's a very simple and rugged system you can deploy very quickly. And so one of the good things about the urban environment is that you are under the cellular coverage. So you can have compact IP-enabled sensors that will sense, compute, and communicate. So once you have that, you can utilize the cloud web services for data storage as well as computing and analysis, and you have a totally scalable system. So you can deploy, if you have the resources, say 1,000 such sensors. And we are planning on doing that, utilizing that infrastructure for real-time soil moisture observations as well. So what you're looking at here is the strip-type TDR sensor that is capable of sensing migration of wetting front. Okay, so I want to give you very quickly what we are doing in terms of fusing or reconciling differences between the model output and these observations through data fusion and data simulation. So we know that if your model is perfect and your QPE is perfect, you can increase your resolution to a very fine scale and expect corresponding improvement in your, say, stream flow simulations. But in reality, your QPE is never perfect. Your model is never perfect. So at some point, with realistic models and QPE, you will hit a threshold beyond which you will degrade your model simulations due to nonlinear accretion and accumulation of growth of errors. So it is really important to be able to produce the highest quality possible QPE, rainfall information. So that's the motivation for QPE fusion. The second point is, so when you crowdsource water observations, you're going to end up with a lot of very soft information, subject to conditional biases, not being able to estimate tail ends of the distribution. So we are looking at different types of techniques in improving analysis and prediction of these variables. And lastly, even with added observations, you are going to have very underdetermined inverse problems in your data simulation. By my rough calculation, it turns out that you need roughly 4,000 soil moisture sensors to be able to sense soil moisture at every single tiny urban catchment in DFW. And that is not going to happen. Okay, so a quick example of data fusion. So in DFW, we have three QPEs available. The weather service MPE, and then Q2 out of NSSL, and then CASA QPE from the regional urban testbed. So the question is, can you fuse all these and produce more accurate QPE? So an example of fusing Q2 and MPE, so this is at 1 kilometer, 15-minute resolution. This is hourly and 4 kilometer resolution. So we are testing different techniques to do this. And it turns out that this is not easy because you want to improve on these QPEs at their native resolutions as well as the upscaled or downscaled resolutions. So if you, so you need to beat all these to have a successful fusion algorithm. And it turns out that this rather simple technique we are calling simplified estimation can actually do that. So we want to utilize this capability in the as a post processor for the QPE operation. Okay. So let's just say we now have some sense of the quality of QPE. Then we want to get at optimal resolution of hydrologic modeling, and that's a big question mark because we don't really know what that picture may look like. So we are doing a series of modeling and sensitivity analysis for that purpose in the Arlington and Grand Prairie area. So a quick example, on the x-axis we have the spatial resolution ranging from 4 kilometers to 250 meters, and on the y-axis showing correlation between simulated flow and observed flow. And we are seeing some sensitivity to different to different QPE forcings. Okay, so this is sensitivity to MPE precip, and this is the sensitivity to castle QPE. You see that actually there's a slight increase in scale as the spatial scale decreases, or the spatial resolution increases, which is a good news. But then you see that the castle QPE, which has a higher resolution, doesn't really improve over MPE, except at this location, 6033. And it turns out that that catchment is the fast responding of the three with largest impervious fraction. So the importance of higher resolution QPE becomes more important for such a basin. So we are trying to sort this out, various controls among different conditions. Okay, so as I noted, if you crowdsource, you will end up with a lot of soft information. And those of you who are familiar with kriging, if you do straight weighted least square based analysis, you'll end up with underestimating large values and overestimating smaller values. You don't really pick up the peaks and valleys well. If you impose additional penalty to account for the conditional bias, it turns out you can do better. You can pick up the peaks and valleys. If you apply the same concept to things like Kalman filter, you end up with what I am calling conditional bias penalized Kalman filter, which will do better at the tail ends of the distribution, even though it may reduce performance in the middle portion. But that's not as important if you are into extreme event analysis and predictions. Lastly, very quickly, so what we're looking at is assimilating streamflow observations into a rainfall runoff model, and we are looking at the time series of lower zone soil moisture content. In black is the base model simulation, and in red is what you get if you applied, say, readily available data simulation technique. You see very large departures. And that's because the inverse problem is very underdetermined. And there are many possible solutions that will give you reasonable flow simulations, kind of like this. If you account for multi-scale processes in your rainfall runoff models, you can do better in the sense that your updated soil moisture will track much more closely the base model simulations. So this is what we're pursuing, because we know that even with additional observations, the DA problems is going to be largely underdetermined. So as I mentioned, this has just started, and we'll be working with many users and stakeholders in the area. But we are also interested in working with additional science partners to work on these topics in the next 4 years. So if you're interested, please let me know. And thank you very much.
Thank you very much. We have time for